Hello everyone! Welcome to the Star Wars The Old Republic 7.2 game update livestream. I'm one of your co-hosts today, Jackie, Sword Tours Community Manager.
Eric Musco, lead game producer.
Yeah, we're back.
We are back.
We have a lot of stuff to talk about.
Oh man, we have been so ready to talk about 7.2 for a long time. Mm-hmm. I'm sure just as much as you've been ready to hear about it. So we're going to tell you the whole thing.
Yeah, before we get into the agenda for today, a couple of things to note. Just like with the 7.1 livestream, we're trying out some new things. So you're going to be seeing some familiar faces today. You're also going to be hearing from some unfamiliar faces. There's going to be a couple of devs who will be making an appearance on the stream, but they're not in the office with us right now, so they're going to have pre-recorded videos, so just as a heads up. And then also, like, if I tend to kind of, like, look this way a little bit, I'm saying hi to everyone in chat. I see Chill's Room. Hi! Hello, I'm pretty sure I saw Sor Teresa and Marcus. Loving the butt. Thank you. I tried really hard. My scalp is very big mad at me, though. But I'm glad that y'all love the hairstyle. All right, let's get into what we're talking about today.
Yep. So, what is coming in 7.2? So we'll give you the list right out of the gates. So at the very top, we have a new planet coming to the game called Ruhnuk.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to get to hear all about that today. The storyline for 7.2, actually the name of the game update, is Showdown on Ruhnuk. So you're going to learn about what's happening in the Crit Path story, the new characters that you're going to be meeting, or returning characters. After you complete the story, it's also going to open up into a new daily area with a whole bunch of stuff going on that planet. You'll have the missions and the rewards that are going to come from that as well.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, one other thing, I didn't even think about it. We didn't call it out on there, but we also have a world boss coming to Ruhnuk as well.
Yeah.
She wasn't even on that slide.
Yeah, so with the story part, it's going to open up with Ashley. Mm-hmm. Ashley Ruhl, who is our narrative director, and Robby Lamb, who is a senior environment artist. And then it'll move over to Caitlin and Jay.
Yep.
Because Jay's new to the stream, so
super excited. And I love that we held right on where it says changes to PvP, because I'm sure no one in chat wants to hear about that. So, we're going to talk about what's happening to PvP going mm-hmm. forward. This is quite a big change, some good set of changes coming for you for that as well.
Oh, and
a
ton of effort, colossal team effort went into the UI UX updates that we'll be showing off today.
Yeah, that's really one exciting bullet, but it's a whole lot. Mm-hmm. So we'll be talking a lot about what's coming there.
Yep.
Hearing.
You're going to be hearing from someone new, not necessarily new in terms of if you've read the dev tracker, you've seen Bryant Wood make several posts on the dev tracker. So you're going to be hearing from Bryant about 7.2 gearing.
Yep.
And then I'm going to be joined by Bradley Lewis, who's going to be talking about some of the cartel market items. There's some really cool stuff in there. So we're going to give you a little bit of a sneak peek into what's going to be coming with 7.2.
Yep.
And we're going to go into Life Day events.
Yep, Life Day is coming back with new rewards, like it does every other winter.
Mm-hmm.
And speaking of?
Launching this winter!
Yep, not going to bury the lead. You'll get it soon.
Yeah!
We're almost in winter. Winter is what, a month? I don't know when winter starts.
It's whenever it's really cold.
Yeah. Sometimes, not really in Texas, but yep. So, there you go. We're going to go through all of that. We'll get through all of those sections. But before any of that, free stuff.
I mean, it's a live stream, so therefore we have some cool stuff to give away. Make sure you head over to swotor.com/redeem-code for a Gallo Stronghold deco. The code is LotSGallore. Easy to remember. I'm really proud of this one. Capitalization does not matter, so make sure that you redeem this before November 16th.
Yep. Get your free Gallo deco.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Yep.
So Musco and I are going to pass the mics over to Ashley and Robby, so don't go anywhere.
Yep.
So be right back.
Yeah, so just like last time, there'll be like a slight break while we are literally, because we are physically in a room doing a live stream, we're going to hand off the mics to Ashley and Robby, and Jackie and I will be back. Don't worry, you'll be hearing from us later.
Okay. Cool.
Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I am Ashley Ruhl. I am the narrative director on Star Wars The Old Republic, and I am joined by...
Hi, I'm Robby Lamb. I'm a senior environment artist on SWTOR, and we're here to talk about the planet of Ruhnuk today.
So a little bit of a recap for our showdown on Ruhnuk's story chapter. We are picking up from the Spirit of Vengeance, where Hedda Kohl attacked Shay's flagship, the Spirit of Vengeance. And Shay has been on the hunt to find Hedda Kohl, and she has cornered her and found her base on the planet of Ruhnuk. And so now asks your help to help take down Hedda Kohl. The planet of Ruhnuk is completely new to SWTOR, and to talk a little bit more about the artistic inspiration behind Ruhnuk, Robby, I'll give you a little bit of detail on that.
Yeah, thank you, Ashley. So Ruhnuk itself is a dry, arid planet. It often does have deep river valleys that are cut through it as well. Let's see, where do I am? Dry river valley planet. It does have valleys cut through it as well. There's a lot of, initially a mining facility that it was used as amongst the first inhabitants. As you can see, we took a lot of reference from places such as the Grand Canyon. We took places from mining facilities out of Arizona for copper, the Colorado Plateaus. As we mentioned earlier, it is a dry desert planet. However, it does rain, not often, but when it does pour. Thus, you'll find a lot of water, river valley canyons, as well as lush foliage, such as Lambro growing in the area. There is one downside to the planet is that it does have a giant nebula that encases and hides the planet, which has caused a ship to have crashed into the atmosphere. And we're here to explore it and see where we go from there.
Yeah. Love that. I love that contrast of the desert and the greenery. Everything together looks really beautiful.
Yeah, thank you.
So Hedda Kohl found this planet and took it over, basically, one, because there was a lot of stuff left there from an abandoned mining operation, so that was something that they could use to build their base. But also, it is very obscured by the nebula, and the nebula makes it very difficult to land or find the planet. However, Shay has found the planet, so she is asking your help to take down Hedda Kohl, and that's where our story begins. So we're going to show a little bit of the beginning of the story, not too many spoilers, just a little introduction of Shay approaching the Alliance commander to talk about what their next step is. After we show this clip, we'll be passing it over to Jay Watanamiuk to talk about the friends and foes you'll be meeting along the way on your journey to Ruhnuk.
So that's Ruhnuk. Hedda Kohl's base of operations?
That's right. I also managed to piece together more about her. One thing doesn't track. She moves like a Mando, fights like she's been trained by the best, but I couldn't find a clan affiliation. I'm certain she's one of us, but it's strange. Whatever she is, people follow her. Years back, she ran a small team of outcasts for a while. They became her inner circle. This group was responsible for several raids against both Republic and Imperial interests. She owes nothing to either side.
My name is Jay Watamaniuk, and I wrote the main story for the events on Ruhnuk with a lot of help from the team, and specifically Caitlin and Ashley. Thank you very much, both of you, for your time and patience. Now, I've been with BioWare for about 21 years, if you can believe that. The last 2.5 have been spent on the Old Republic. When I joined, they asked me if I wanted to sketch out a plot that would bring back some of these Mandalorian clans we had in the game, but we just hadn't seen for a while. I agreed. I thought that sounds like a great plan. I'll get right on that. And so for today, for Ruhnuk, Jackie asked me if I would talk about the enemies and allies you're likely to encounter on Ruhnuk. So let's start at the top. The big bad, Field Marshal Hedda Cole. She was first introduced in the Spirit of Vengeance Flashpoint. We don't learn much about her, except that she's very good at gathering, let's call them fringe Mandalorian clans, under her own banner, which she calls the Hidden Chain. Now, what they did was attack Shae Vizsla's flagship, called the Spirit of Vengeance, hence the name, which was shocking. Shae Vizsla is the official leader of all Mandalorians. She is Mandalore the Avenger. So for someone to attack her flagship, stunning. But Hedda Cole didn't do this alone. She had help. One of those people is a guy named Bask Sun. What to say about this guy? He is certainly more interested in making money, credits, rather than risking his own neck. He is in charge of the sort of local chapter of a group called Darmanda, Mercenaries for Hire. He makes deals. He's a survivor. We'll definitely see him on Ruhnuk. Someone else who works with Hedda is Rakan. Different character from Bask. He is ruthlessly loyal to Hedda Cole. Why? We're not sure. But one curious fact about Rakan is he is the brother to Sahar. Sahar we met fighting for her life against Darth Malgus. She's a very powerful Padawan that is now caught up in all these galactic events, and now because of her brother, Mandalorian politics. And we're not sure where she sits in all of this quite yet. Now, moving from enemies to allies, we met two people in the Spirit of Vengeance that we'll meet again on Ruhnuk, Jakaya Ordo and his younger brother, Rass Ordo. They're both Mandalorians. Rass was actually the one that accompanied you through the Spirit of Vengeance to help retake that flagship. Now, at the end of the Spirit of Vengeance, just as a note, Shae Vizsla said, you know what? I'm going to go hunt down Hedda Cole myself. I'm going to leave all my duties, my responsibilities in the hands of Jakaya as the arbiter, and I'm going to hunt down Hedda Cole. So Jakaya speaks with Shae Vizsla's voice on all manner of Mandalorian things while she is gone. That leaves us with two more. Now, in the midst of all this Mandalorian drama, we're not to exclude these two, Akavi Spar and Torian Cadera. Torian has a special connection, a surprising connection, actually, to what's going on here, because if you will remember, Hedda Cole made a special point of going after, searching for, and stealing the Cadera family banner from the Spirit of Vengeance. The Spirit of Vengeance was hauling a bunch of Mandalorian relics at the time. Not sure what's going on there. I think the last thing I want to say is to fill in the gaps between the events of the Spirit of Vengeance and Ruhnuk, I wrote some stories. The first one was called Seeing Red. It was released earlier this year, I think, and it dealt with Rass and Jakaya dealing with their first major crisis in the Mandalorians after Shae Vizsla was gone on her hunt. I wrote a couple other short stories, which have not been released yet, which deal with Shae Vizsla hunting Hedda Cole. How did she get from the end of Spirit of Vengeance to finding her on Ruhnuk? And that's what those short stories deal with. Last thing I want to say is a big thank you to the team. Huge amount of work was put into this. It's always humbling working with such skilled professionals on something like this. And I hope that you enjoy Showdown on Ruhnuk, the next chapter in the Mandalorian Civil Wars.
All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Caitlin Sullivan Kelly, and I am the lead writer for Star Wars The Old Republic. I hope you're all enjoying the brief look into what we've been so hard at work on for the story for Game Update 7.2, Showdown on Ruhnuk. Thanks to Ashley and Robby for sharing a couple of the details with us about the environment for Ruhnuk and the main story. And of course, thanks to Jay for going through all of the main characters that you're going to meet during the story and getting us hyped up for the short stories that he's written in anticipation for the story. So I'm here today to talk to you all a little bit about the daily area that we're introducing with 7.2. To start off with, let's kick it off with the story arc that's going to be coming in the daily area.
So similar to the story that we introduced with 7-1 in the Manon Daily area, once you finish the main story on Ruhnuk, we're actually going to direct players back to Ruhnuk for a 3-mission story arc where players will be assisting Mandalore the Avengers forces on Ruhnuk in the aftermath of the main story. They will be helping those forces track down one of Hedicole's most ruthless followers, who's conducting some super secret experiments that not even Hedicole herself knows about. With the main story, we're kind of following these two super, super big personalities, these big titans in the form of Shay Vizsla and Hedicole. So with this story, we're kind of more leaning into and focusing on the goals and the desires for some of the characters that are in their command. And what's super cool about the story arc is all of the characters that you're going to meet are actually fully voiced. So let's share a couple of the two that you will meet on this journey. The first one that we've got here is Lane Vizsla. She is the main point of contact for the player during the story arc. Vizsla, yes, a very familiar name. Lane is actually a distant cousin of Shay Vizsla. The two of them share quite a few traits. Lane is also very stubborn, very adamant about proving herself. And because of that, she doesn't really like people knowing that she and Shay are related. She thinks that leaves the door open to accusations of nepotism and special treatment. Lane's also a big tinkerer. She has a really keen interest in a lot of Mandalorian technology, especially the Basilisk War Droids. And Lane is also a very blunt personality. She has no qualms about letting you know exactly how she feels about something or someone, like her rival, Kerr Harangir, who is this gentleman right here. Kerr Harangir is actually the main antagonist of the Daily Area story arc. He is a member of Clan Harangir, who is a new clan that we're introducing as some of Hedda's followers in 7-2. And Clan Harangir is a very old name. They're a very wealthy clan, a very arrogant clan, and Kerr Harangir is kind of the embodiment of that arrogance, that is the epitome of that clan. Kerr also, like Lane, has an interest in technology, but unlike Lane, he doesn't really care about preserving the special technology for the future generations. For Kerr, all he cares about is having the biggest and the best, the most powerful, the strongest, and the most expensive toys. So in addition to the Daily Area story, now that we've got a new Daily Area, we're also going to have a new reputation track, which we are calling the Mandalorian Tratade on Ruhnuk. Tratade is Mandoa for forces, and it's basically Mandalore the Avenger, Shay Vizsla's forces, who are going up against Hedicole. As we mentioned before in the presentation, Ruhnuk is a very inhospitable, very hard to colonize place, but Hedicole is doing her darndest to set up a base of operations there on the back of some existing infrastructure that was left behind, and it'll be up to the player to help the Mandalorian Tratade keep Hedicole from digging in too deep in her foothold. So as you complete different missions, including the Daily Area story arc on Ruhnuk, you'll earn more and more influence with the Mandalorian Tratade. We've got two new legacy titles that will be available in 7-2 as you move up the track. At friend rank, we have Bamandalore Tamad, which means ally of Mandalore. And when you complete the track, you will unlock the legacy title Parjila Gaetik, which is roughly translates to Triumphant Story, which I think is a fitting title for actually completing a legend rank of the reputation track. And on the reputation vendor, we'll have a couple of character titles available as well that you can unlock. Those are Champion of the Avenger, which is to recognize your help in helping Mandalore the Avenger, Shay Vizsla, keep things going on Ruhnuk. And there's also Celebrated and Remembered, which is kind of a nod to a Mandalorian ceremony where they honor their great warriors. So in addition to titles, we've got several other really cool rewards coming with the reputation track. Most of these, of course, will be available through the reputation vendor, but a couple of these will be planetary drops as well. And a few of those examples are what you see here, the Ruhnuk and Mushroom Tree Stronghold decoration, and the Ruhnuk and Lambro decoration, which is this little cactus-like plant here that's a really cool stronghold decoration. A couple of more previews of some stronghold decorations you can get from the reputation vendor. As we mentioned earlier, there was a mining expedition on Ruhnuk that ended in disaster. And as the workers fled, they were forced to abandon a lot of their equipment, which you'll see as you're exploring Ruhnuk. And we've also are offering them in the form of the stronghold decorations. We've also got a Mandalorian shuttle decoration because you'll be fighting and assisting a lot of different Mandalorians on Ruhnuk. There's also going to be mini pets, armor, and this really cool Wetlands Mudhorn mount. So what else is coming in the daily area in 7.2? We're going to be offering a wide variety of repeatable daily, heroic, and weekly missions. We're also introducing a new slate of planetary achievements that are going to encourage you to explore, take on the biggest and baddest enemies, and complete some of these repeatable missions. There's going to be a new Datacron puzzle on Ruhnuk. And one thing that I think is really cool that we started doing in 7.1 on the Manon daily area was the gameplay buffs that you got as you completed the daily area story arc. We actually allowed you to unlock a new buff after you completed each mission. And we're keeping that same idea for 7.2. We're just changing the concept a little bit and how you unlock these. Now, after you finish the main story on Ruhnuk, you'll be offered what we're calling Mandalorian relic quests. They're basically a treasure hunt. And some of Hedicol's followers have actually kind of stolen these Mandalorian relics and brought them with them to Ruhnuk. And once you completed the main story, like I said, you'll have these quests. You'll be charged with hunting down Hedicol's followers, defeating them, capturing the relics back for the true Mandalorians and bringing them back to base. Once you do, you'll get a super cool gameplay buff that'll make things a little bit easier for you as you're doing your quests in the daily area. And another really cool addition is we are going to have a new weekly world boss on Ruhnuk. Yeah! Who we're calling Kithral, the Flame in Darkness. It's a super cool lizard creature that is got magma and char all over him. That ill-fated mining expedition that I mentioned before dug a little too deep. They made a cavern and they found something that they really didn't like. So that'll be available to do some cool weekly quests. That's it for me. Thank you guys so much for watching. I'm going to hand it back over to Jackie and Musco to talk about PvP changes in 7.2.
We're back. So, me, Jackie, again, joined by Musco, and we're going to be talking about the PvP changes that will be coming with 7.2. I know a lot of you are incredibly eager for this part of the stream. So, before we get into all the nitty-gritty details, I just want to preface this. It's really important for you all to understand the philosophies and the reasoning and, like, our goals for what inspired the changes for PvP. So, Musco's going to take the bulk of it.
Yep.
And then-
Yeah, so kind of as Jackie said, when we kind of approach anything from the design side, we really want to make sure that we have some pretty clear goals in mind of what we're trying to achieve. And if you think of each of these three goals that are on the screen as kind of like a Venn diagram, the things that we're going to talk through that are coming with our revamp to PvP are going to hit one, two, or all of these changes and some of the changes that we're making. So just talk through them really quickly. Increase PvP participation. I think this is something that all of you would agree with. The more players that are playing PvP, the better quality matches, the shorter queue times, etc. We want to encourage positive play, and this is kind of, and you'll see kind of some of the changes we're doing to achieve this, but there's just a few things that were kind of a part of the existing PvP gameplay types that could not necessarily be healthy behaviors that we wanted people to do. And we didn't create great systems necessarily to encourage you to do the things that were positive in the nature of PvP. And last and certainly not least is ensure PvP is rewarding. Jokes aside, obviously playing PvP is its own reward. A lot of you will play PvP every day and lots of matches because that's the fun of it. But also we want to make sure that you're getting rewards for doing so. And I'm not talking about gear here. I'm talking about, well, you'll see, but we want to make sure that it's rewarding. So what exactly is the PvP revamp? Let's get into it. First, we're condensing our queues. So before, right now, as a SWTOR of you know it, we have unranked and we have ranked. Unranked can participate in war zones and arenas. Ranked is, of course, just in 4v4 arenas. With 7.2, those are no longer there. So there is no unranked play. There is no ranked play. Now there's just two distinct queues you can queue for. You can queue for 8v8 and you can queue for 4v4. And just like before, you can queue in for those as either solo or as a group. Those aren't distinct queues though. You'll just be queuing into the 4v4 and 8v8 and then be getting match made based on that. So what this really helps with is it'll help drive participation by ensuring that we're funneling people into more distinct queues. Right now, obviously for anyone that has played, especially like ranked in the past, you'd find times of day when there weren't a lot of people playing and those types of things. And so we wanted to try to avoid those problems by, again, kind of condensing the queues together. It encourages positive play because you look at things like take unranked as an example. Let's say you really wanted to play, you just want to play Warzones. You're someone out there who just loves them some Hutball. So you want to just be looking to get Warzone pops, but you queue and you end up in a 4v4 arena. Now you either need to stick out the match, you maybe don't want to participate in it, and you may leave the match or do something. And so again, just trying to make sure that players are doing positive things while they're playing. But none of this addresses rewards, which is obviously something that is important. So let's talk about the rewards you'll be getting as part of this. So here's what our new seasonal structure looks like. And again, we're going to use the word season because it is, in a sense, a season, but don't confuse it with how ranked seasons used to operate. So all PvP players, so again, once you go into the PvP queue, you're either going into 4v4 or 8v8, you're now all participating in the same season. So the first season, which is coming with 7.2, is season one of PvP. It's going to operate very similar to Galactic Seasons. So what you're going to do is when you play matches, and you'll get points each match, and by completing missions that you can complete coming off of those matches, you'll be earning PvP points. Those PvP points will then gain you levels. Those levels will unlock a variety of rewards, which we'll be talking about and showing in a second. And that's the seasonal structure. So again, very similar to Galactic Seasons. One thing I've called out there as PvP points is that we're also updating all of our medals. So right now, any of you that play PvP know, you know, let's say you're playing, you know, a sniper and you come in and you hit an ambush on someone, four medals pop because the numbers haven't been adjusted in a long time. So we're kind of going back and making a pass on our medals just to make sure, and again, to kind of encourage you to participate in the war zone. You will need to participate to earn medals. You won't be able to get them quite as easily as you could before, but those medals will also reflect the PvP points that you earn. I know I can't see chat because I'm not looking down at it, but I have to imagine the one in the middle is something that's drawing some attention. There's no caps on any of your subscription models for the amount of war zones you can play. So previously there was caps on free-to-play players where they could only play 10 a week. Now there's no caps. You can play as many PvP matches as you want, and anyone of any subscription status can participate in all of the rewards for PvP seasons. So if you want to be a free-to-play player and you can still earn every single reward that's in the new PvP seasonal structure, the difference being if you're a subscriber, you'll earn PvP points at twice the rate, so you'll be able to get through the season much quicker to get the rewards. So you can play less technically to get there. In the reward track, you're also going to see there's a new PvP currency. This is replacing ranked PvP tokens. So if you have ranked PvP tokens, spend them because they're going away in 7.2. And this new PvP currency will only be earned through PvP seasons, and you'll be able to purchase another set of rewards that's going to be added on a new vendor that will also get updated every season to purchase those rewards there as well. And our goal, in case you're curious, because obviously with ranked seasons, I think we were pretty inconsistent about exactly how long they ran and over what periods of time. We're definitely aiming for consistency here, so our goal is going to be to run three seasons a year about. And we'll talk specifics about that once we get a little bit closer and into the season. But again, goal is to run three seasons a year at pretty much identical lengths.
I did see a question in chat asking about the PvP tokens. So
yeah, what was the question specifically?
What's happening to them?
What's happening? Yeah, so I called it out a little bit, but yeah, if you have ranked PvP tokens today, they are going away. They're not going to be converted into the new currency or anything. That's starting fresh. So if you have ranked PvP tokens today, spend them. We're going to message this to make sure it's clear so no one misses that, but definitely spend them before 7.2.
Yep. And then I also saw a question about like what rewards can be expected.
Yeah, so
here we go.
Yeah, so we'll start into it here, and then we'll actually show you the full list on the next slide for the most part. So this is what, and again, you'll notice this is very similar to the Galactic Seasons UI and the way that it functions. Note, anything that you see here listed as a reward, number, what level it's at, is TBD, as this is all still being worked out, and you'll get to touch it on PTS, which we'll talk about later. This is what the PvP track looks like. Again, looks very much like the Galactic Seasons UI. It talks about the rate at which you earn, or the points that you've earned towards your weekly totals, the amount of levels you're at, how to claim your rewards here, etc. So what's on the reward track?
Lots of stuff.
So we'll just let it sit here, soak in, so you can read it. But let me give you the high level philosophy of kind of what you're going to expect. And I'll talk a little bit about what's on the reward track, which again is on the screen, and what's on the vendor. So from the reward track, what you'll notice is there are two different armor sets here. So you'll be able to get two full armor sets just from completing the reward track. There's also going to be two armor sets that are going to be on the seasonal reward vendor as well. So there's technically four armor sets you could earn during the course of the season. The reward track is also going to have a variety of titles. It's going to have a variety of stronghold decorations, and then you'll notice every couple of levels also is where the PvP seasons tokens are earnable, which again, you can spend on that vendor for additional rewards as well.
Yep. This is what they look like.
Yeah. So the one on the right, those are the two armor sets that you can earn from the reward track. You'll notice they're similar. One of them is the base armor set, and then later in the track, you can earn that armor set with upgraded VFX on it. Same thing on the left, two different armor sets of similar style that one has and one does not have VFX. And again, those are purchasable on the PvP rewards vendor.
Someone in chat said, you can get TBD. I want TBD.
There you go. Yeah. Yeah. Worth noting, in case you don't know, I appreciate the joke. TBD means to be determined. And so you'll start to see some of that fleshed out on PTS, but we'll be having more details about the very specific decos that you'll be earning in the coming weeks as well.
There's more.
So obviously we can hold on the slide for a second while you digest that. We just threw a lot of information about you for the PvP revamp, but just to give you just the high level rundown again. So ranked and unranked as you knew them today aren't there anymore. Now what we have is just two queues of 4v4 and 8v8 to kind of condense everybody into the same queues. And while playing in there, you're going to notice some other structural updates within the PvP revamp of things like updated medals and stuff to really kind of encourage you to participate in those modes as intended. And then coming out of that, there's a whole new seasonal reward structure to give you really a lot more rewards than we've typically been giving to PvPers, I think. And that's going to run over ideally three seasons a year that you'll see over time. So that's the PvP revamp. I'm sure there'll be more questions, and you know, Jack can pull them out as we go, but that's not it. There's one more thing still for PvPers this
update. Yeah, this is really exciting. I love it. So we have a new 4v4 PvP map. It's called the Onderon Palatial Ruins. It's absolutely beautiful. Environment artists really knocked it out of the park with this one. And when I asked them, I was like, so what was the inspiration for this particular map? And they said, you know, what would an Olympic venue look like on Onderon? And so it kind of gives you a glimpse into an area in Onderon where players don't typically have a lot of insight into. So I think it's beautiful. Pretty. It's so pretty. I love it. I thought it was so beautiful. I was in love with it when I first saw it. One special note, I encourage y'all to explore in that map. You might find a place that takes you to another little place that's also kind of cool. So just as a heads up.
I don't know what Jackie's talking about, so let me know when you find out.
I know something that you don't. You did see a question.
Yeah. Sorry, I saw one question. Someone asked, I only want to queue for 8v8, but will I be queued for both? So, again, one of the changes that we really wanted to differentiate, especially, again, kind of looking at the lessons between unranked and ranked, and one of the things we could see in unranked is because the unranked queue could populate you into a war zone or an arena, we wanted to separate those two because they are dramatically different gameplay types. And so, no, if you queue for 4v4, you will only get placed into an arena. If you queue for a war zone, you will only get placed in a war zone in an 8v8 match. If you want to queue for both, go ahead, and then you can kind of look at it as kind of the way the old queue used to work. But no, we are separating them by war zones, so 8v8 gameplay, and arenas 4v4 gameplay. Mm-hmm. Yep.
All right, so...
And we know you'll have tons of feedback. We've been watching, kind of scrolling through chat. Again, we'll talk about PTS later in the stream. It's going to be coming to PTS. Obviously, I can only imagine with the forums, you're already there posting your feedback now. That's great. We want to hear what you think, because obviously this is some pretty big changes coming to PvP that we've been talking about for a long time. So, Yep.
And those are the changes for PvP. And just as a reminder, we have a Stronghold deco of Colonel Gallo for you. So make sure you go to sortor.com/redeem-code. Redeem the code LotsGallore. Capitalization does not matter. I know that question comes up quite often, but it actually does not matter. And make sure you redeem it before November 16th. And tweet at Sotor. I want to see where y'all putting this deco in your strongholds. I love seeing your strongholds. I really do.
One question. I've seen a bunch of different flavors of this question, so I'll just kind of answer it. People being like, can you queue for this mode as one with one player, two players, three players, eight players? The intention is that you can queue. There isn't like a solo queue for 4v4 or a group queue for 8v8. You can queue for your group size into any of the queues, and then matchmaking will try to pair you with other, like if you're a pre-made, it will try to pair you with other pre-mades, etc. I think we're probably going to talk a little bit about some matchmaking stuff we've been working on too down the line, but yes, you can queue to your group size in either mode. There isn't a locked fixed set in either one of the queues. Yep.
Oh, cool. So that's PvP changes. We are going to bring on Bryant, who is our systems designer. However, he is not in the office with us. He is going to have a pre-recorded video, but he's going to be going into the gearing changes coming in Game Update 7.2.
Hey everyone, I'm Bryant Wood, a systems designer on Star Wars The Old Republic. I'm here to tell you about the gearing and progression changes coming in patch 7.2. In 7.2, we'll be increasing the power ceiling for the second time. This means you'll be able to obtain stronger gear by playing. Here are the new power ceilings for 7.2. Noble, Elite, and Supreme Decurion gear from Conquest and Flashpoints, as well as Tienes, Kalumi, and Rakata gear from Operations, will all be upgradable to item rating 336. Thirzian gear, available from PvP, will be upgradable to item rating 332. There will be no changes to the R4 Anomaly gear released with 7.1, but we will be gathering feedback around that gearing system in the forums. How about those new forums? Next, in 7.2, we'll be doing our first increase to the Power Floor. The Power Floor is the lowest item rating given in what we consider endgame. Power Floor increases are done to reduce the time required for new players to catch up and participate in the endgame community. They'll happen as we continue to raise the power ceiling, but will happen less often than ceiling increases. Right now, the power floor is item rating 318 for PvP and 320 for PvE content. Patch 7.2 will see this item rating increased to 322 for PvP and 324 for PvE. We'll also be increasing the gear rewarded from the Legacy of the Sith story missions to item rating 322. While these are the biggest changes coming to gear in 7.2, they're not everything. Check out the forums for a more detailed look at the upcoming changes, including new legendary implants, currency conversions, and making it easier to identify upgradable gear. I'll see you all another time. I'm helping prep ingredients for this year's Feast of Prosperity.
Yeah, so Brian's going to be posting later on sometime this week with a gearing post, and also somewhat related. I know some people have some questions about class balances. You'll be hearing from either Christorel or Shabir Dillon. They'll be making a post in the forums as well sometime this week about class balance changes.
Yep. So honestly, maybe the biggest section we have to talk about today, I don't know, it's all big today. There's a lot, there's a lot of stuff. So UI UX update. So one, we've broken it down to the acronym, but just in case for some reason you don't know what that means. So UI meaning user interface, so the things you interface with on your screen, and then UX meaning user experience. So this is like, think of like quality of life in the game related to, in a lot of cases, the user interface, but sometimes in other cases, other things as well. So we haven't actually told you what those features are. So let's talk about them, because there's a whole bunch of stuff. So top of the list, map revamp. This is a bunch of different things that are crazy, and I'm really excited to talk to you about them. So we'll get to those in a second. We're going to show you what those are. Updated tooltips. This is just quality of life. One little quality of life improvement for the tooltips you know and love.
We will also show you that.
We will also show you that. Customizable utility bar. You'll say, I don't know what that means. Great. We're going to explain it, and we're going to show it to you in a second, but it's more UI customization for you. And the thing that I am so excited to have on a screen coming into the game for you, colorblind mode is coming to SWTOR in 7.2. It's it's an accessibility feature we have been wanting to get in for a really long time, and the team has really crushed it in getting it to you for 7.2. So very, very excited. And we'll show you that too, so you'll be able to see what
that
looks like
as well.
I'm going to
show a little bit of that with the colorblind mode with the icons wheel?
Yeah, right. We obviously started taking stuff like that into account when we were looking at things like the combat style icons and stuff, making sure that we had colorblind presets. So now your whole screen will be adjustable for colorblind. Deconstruct and delete window. This is basically self-explanatory, but basically we're adding delete into the deconstruct window, but we'll show it to you anyway, just so you know what it looks like. Okay, so before we press the start, let's talk about what's on the screen, because you may notice some changes. So if I can draw your attention to the bottom right of the screen, you're going to say, that minimap looks different, and you would be correct. So this is an update to the visuals of our minimap to kind of reflect a little bit of our new style that we've kind of been moving towards in 7.0 and beyond. And the big thing that you're noticing is, where are my icons? How do I zoom in and out? So if you look right below the minimap, you're gonna see that bar, which has those radial icons on it. That, my friends, is the customizable utility bar, which we'll also be talking about in a second. So before we push play, the very first feature that we're going to be showing you, we're calling it our pop-out map. And you know what? We'll just play the video, and you'll see it in a second. So imagine if you wanted to be able to see more detail than your minimap can show. How about that?
Isn't that so cool?
So this is basically, we've taken your map, the press M and pull up the map, and one of the ways you can view it, your regular map's not gone, don't worry, you can just pull it up as a partially transparent full-size map on the side of your screen. It has all of the same functionality as kind of your map and mini map combined, so you can change filters, you can adjust scale as you just saw by clicking there, and you can change filters. The other thing you might notice too is that your map, you can now see underneath Fog of War. We kind of had put a partial version of this out in the past, but so this is, again, you can see kind of here's what Fog of War revealing would look like. And again, just to reiterate, this is a new version of the way you can engage with our maps. If you want to just use the map exactly as it was today, it is still there. This is just another way while you're out traveling around the galaxy, if you wanted to have a little bit more visibility into the things that are there. Other last note before we move on to the next thing is that this entire map can be, because obviously this is pretty big for scale, so we can show you how it looks. All of that can be opened, adjusted in the interface editor, so you can adjust how big it is on your screen. I think you can even adjust its transparency. So fully customizable for the pop-out map. So excited for this feature.
Other note, I believe. I know we're talking about PTS a little bit later, but with the map specifically, I think with PTS, we're trying to figure out what is natural to the player. So when PTS goes live.
Right. Yeah, it's a good call out, right? Because we're going to show you a bunch of different stuff, some of which is new, some of which is adjusted to things that are already there. Defaults might change. Key bindings of things might change. And so we really want to make sure that that's the kind of thing that you're giving us feedback on, like what should be the hotkey to make the pop-out map change from the mini map and those types of things. So yeah, that's a good call out of things we'll be looking at on PTS.
The chat's going crazy.
Yeah.
I love it.
So next up is tooltips. Question mark, is this tooltips?
Yes.
I couldn't remember the order. So here's the tooltips you know and love. It's popping up above your mini map in the fixed position it was before. Well, if you don't want them there, what if instead you could not have them attached to the minimap? So you check that box off, and then now instead they were just pinned to your mouse
pointer.
Minor change, but a huge quality of life improvement. So if that's how you would prefer to have tooltips, again, you still have the same customization options you had before. But you can pin tooltips to your mouse, which is great. Okay, next on the list is utility bar.
Yeah,
sure.
Lots of customization coming to utility bar.
So utility bar, surprise, there's actually two of them. So the one in the bottom right is the one you see us modifying right now. The one in the top left is where the welcome window and chat pops out of. That is also now a customizable utility bar. So what you can see here is that, and I forget the number of slots, but I think it's 10 plus for each of them. You have a preset selection of icons that you can put on those bars, and you can customize from that entire dropdown which ones you want to show up and not show up. My favorite example, joke I made earlier, is imagine you say, I don't need to know what time it is. I'm going to play as late as I want. We'll just turn the clock off. We're not the boss of you. Don't worry about what time it is, right? So all of that is customizable. Again, you can turn the icons on and off kind of as you see fit. And again, you can see that it is customizes both the top and bottom versions of the utility bar.
Oh, this is so cool.
Really, really excited about this feature. Again, it was kind of a nice little knock on from the changes we made to the minimap, but I honestly think this kind of cleans up the screen space quite a bit. And so very, very excited for this. I think one of the cool things too, I think I even saw that you can even put like dividers as opposed to just icons and stuff, right? So like if you're like me, who's real, I would say OCD, but like real particular about the order of things in your bars, you have a lot of flexibility. So very, very excited for this.
This one, I'm super duper excited.
Yeah,
hype. Go ahead.
Okay.
Get that hype up. Colorblind mode, baby!
Yep. So there are three types of colorblind mode that are coming. You can see them right here. It's protanopia, deuteranopia, and tryptanopia. I believe mm-hmm. I pronounced them correctly, but someone can tell me if I'm wrong. But you can see them. Here you go. This is them in action. It is just this simple to switch between three colorblind modes. It happens on the fly. There's really not a lot to say about this, but there's so much to say about it because it really is just such an exciting thing to finally come into SWTOR. So.
Yeah, it's all game, but I believe a little minor note is that I don't think it applies in loading screens.
Oh, interesting.
Because there's like so much happening at once in that very short amount of time, so you might not see it apply to loading screens, but everywhere else in the game.
Interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. See colorblind mode.
Yep. Very, so excited.
I made notes.
Well done, Jackie. This isn't a video, but this is what it is. When you pop up the deconstruct window, we've now added another section for delete. So this would be if you have a bunch of stuff, just an example of, let's say, you really want to pull a helmet down to customize your appearance and you pop the whole armor set out of collections and you just now need to delete it instead of drag, drop, okay, drag, drop, okay. You can just, similar to the old deconstruct functionality, right click it or drag and drop them in there. And when you click that button in the bottom middle, it will do whatever is relevant. So if it can be deconstructed or deleted, it will do the appropriate action for those items. No changes to the actual deconstruct functionality, but basically we've just added mass delete as another added feature as well.
First time chatter, all caps. Oh my God, delete window. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. I know for people, depending on the things that you engage with, sometimes you really just need to delete stuff and you really don't want to do it one at a time. So this is, again, just another one of those nice little small quality of life improvements that I think really does a lot for your day-to-day gameplay.
Can we do that for real life? I need that for all the
time. Massa, man.
In my place.
I cannot help you with that. No, I can't.
Womp womp.
Yep.
All right.
So that is all of the UI UX stuff. Again, just to recap, we have map changes to the mini map and the pop-up map for the whole map revamp that has the knock-on effects to the utility window, which is customizable both top and bottom. We have updates to unpinning tooltips and having them on your mouse pointer, added mass delete to deconstruct, and last but not least, colorblind mode.
Yeah.
Just so much stuff coming from the UI UX team. They really crushed it this update. I'm really excited for all of you to get your hands on all of this on PTS, which I know I keep saying and we'll talk about at the end of the stream. But that's enough for me talking. I'm going to step out for a minute and let Brad come in and talk to you about the cool stuff that's coming to the crypto market. And then I'll be back to talk about Life Day and wrap things up.
Yep. BRB.
Yep. I'll be right back.
back. I'm joined by Bradley Lewis, who is our art monetization director, and he is such a lovely human being. I wanted to bring him on the stream to introduce him to all of you.
Well, hello, everyone. I'm Brad Lewis. I'm the art monetization director for Star Wars The Old Republic, and my job is to work with a really amazing team of artists and engineers and designers to come up with all sorts of fun things for the players to enjoy available in the cartel market. Mm-hmm. I'm here today to talk about some of the things we've got for 7.2.
Yep. So with that, a little sneak peek. First up, we got Master Wars lightsaber. Look at that.
Right, this one.
So cool.
This one features some high fidelity blade and hilt effects with a nice texture set. And this one has also a really great sound effect when you ignite it, which we worked on pretty closely with the audio folks, and I'm really happy with how it turned out. I think the players are gonna love it. I love it. This one is special to me because when I got the call to design this one, I actually went out in the garage and in my little machine shop, actually built it in real life as sort of a real life concept. I do that with some of the things in the cartel market historically, so that when I go to model them in 3D for the game, I'll have them in hand to reference, and here it is.
I can hold it?
Sure.
Yeah, okay. This is so cool. Oh my gosh, I wonder if I can just, can we get it like, oh, there we go. Yeah.
But it was—
Isn't that awesome?
It was great fun to be able to do this. I do this every now and then with our cartel market weapons. Like I said, just to have something tangible to be able to model, model from a little bit better.
Like anytime when I tell people, it's like, oh, no, he made the thing. No, I mean, like, he actually made the thing.
Yes. Up next, we've got the this great armor set inspired by the Book of Boba Fett's Pike Syndicate outfits. It's got a really high fidelity texture set. It's got some animated bits on the helmet. We're really pleased with how this has turned out, and we hope the players enjoy it. Mm-hmm. Next up, the ceremonial Beskar blade. This is featured in the cinematic in 7.2 quite prominently, so we thought that if players got to see it, they might want to have it. So anytime we get an opportunity to make something available to players that they see in the game while they're playing the story content, we try to make that happen.
Yeah, this is so cool. I want to say stuff that I'm pretty sure I'll get filtered for, but it's so cool. I can't wait for all of you to see it.
And lastly, we have Rakan's Vibro Axe. This one has a collapsible blade section and some lightning and particle effects that are tied to color crystal. And this one also features a game first for us on the weapon side, where we mimicked the vibroblade effect from the Mandalorian, the shimmery kind of vibroblade effect you might see in some of the fight scenes. We actually added that to this weapon. So it'll be the first weapon in the store, or in the game rather, that has that effect. So we're pretty happy with that one too.
You and this team do such amazing work.
I
want you to know this. I'm telling all of you right now, like, you all do so.
Thank you very much.
Beautiful work.
It's a challenge, but it's a very rewarding one. So.
Yeah. Thank you for being here.
Absolutely. Thank you all for.
This is just a sneak peek, by the way.
Oh, like, there's more coming.
This is just a few items, giving you like a little bit of a hint.
Right.
So Can I hold on to this for the rest of the stream?
For the rest of the stream.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah. All right, so we're going to bring Musco back.
Okay.
And talk about Let the Event.
Great.
And all that fun stuff. Thank you. Never letting go of this. I'm just saying.
I came back in the room. I'm afraid for my... Jackie's just clutching a lightsaber as I come back in the room. I don't...
You know, when we were doing the practice run, I asked him, like, how long it took to for him to make this. And he said, like, 4 months.
It's crazy.
4 months.
It's crazy.
But anyways, I'm holding on to this.
Brad builds amazing stuff.
Yes.
We need to just do a showcase of the crazy things he's built. To be fair, you have a bunch of them in game, so I guess there's that showcase, too.
Now you know who makes them.
Yeah. Life Day.
Yes. Moving on to Life Day events.
Yep.
So it'll be running for about 5 weeks, beginning with 7.2 launch. And we do have some new rewards that are coming.
Yep.
Y'all love those snow globes.
They are awesome.
There are 4 new snow globes coming. So there are 4 themed, Manon themed, Ruhnuk, and Ilum. And then also there's a Gala hat too. I didn't have the video on here, but that blue gem on the hat, it actually shimmers. So there is a effect on it. It's really, really, really pretty.
Yep, they're very cool.
Yeah, and also, highly encourage y'all to check out the fleet when Life Day event is here. Just saying.
It gets festive.
It's very pretty. It's very pretty. Yeah, I know that y'all were really excited about Life Day, so
yep.
Happy to say there's new rewards coming.
Yep. The text has just gotten progressively smaller on this slide.
Did you back up?
I did. Which is fine, because like I have 20/20 vision, so I don't it's almost like I'm like farsighted. I don't know why I did that, actually. And this isn't, I'll say it verbally, because obviously it's not even entirely on here. Like UI UX update, there's still just one bullet, even though you know there's a bunch. So again, just to recap everything coming in 7.2. And to be fair, it's not everything, because there's still like detailed stuff like class changes and things that aren't even captured here. But new planet, you're going to for Ruhnuk, where that's where the story will continue. And obviously you met some of the characters and stuff that you'd be interfacing with while you're there. As you complete the Ruhnuk story, it's going to open to a new daily area with new rewards and a world boss, also not on that list. Changes coming to PvP. Obviously, we've talked about a lot there in the condensing of the queues and the new seasonal structure and all that stuff. So definitely be sure to give us your feedback there. UI UX updates. Again, so that includes the mapping revamp, customizable utility bar, quality of life for tooltips, mass delete being added into deconstruct, and colorblind mode, of course. New updates to floors and ceilings and acquisition, as Bryant outlined. Again, thank you, Bryant, for 7.2's gearing. New cartel market items, like what's the that Jackie's going to murder me with in the chair soon. You keep pointing it at me. I don't know.
Oh, sorry.
I feel threatened. New cartel market items coming in 7.2. The return of Life Day, and all of it is coming.